passage of scripture before we allow our children to move. 1 Kings, the 17th chapter. Amen. We were just in the neighborhood before. 1 Kings, chapter 17. Verses 1 through 7. 1 Kings 17, 1 through 7. And Elijah the Tishbite, who was of the inhabitants of Gilead, said unto Ahab, As the Lord God of Israel liveth, before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain these years, but according to my word. And the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, Get thee hence, and turn thee eastward, and hide thyself by the brook Cherith, that is before Jordan. And it shall be that thou shalt drink of the brook. And I have commanded the ravens to feed thee there. So he went and did according unto the word of the Lord. For he went and dwelt by the brook Cherith, that is before Jordan. And the ravens brought him bread and flesh in the morning, and bread and flesh in the evening. And he drank of the brook. And it came to pass after a while that the brook dried up because there had been no rain in the land. God bless the reading of the scripture. Let's talk about those ravens. As our children are exiting, let's talk about those ravens. How many of you have intentions of watching the Super Bowl? You know what? Y'all about to quit. Y'all about to quit. Try to make me believe that you have no interest. Amen. Elder Cutherson says he wants to put up both hands. Amen. It is not because I am a tremendous sports fan. I think there are some lessons to be learned from some sports. And certainly there are some disciplines that are learned from some sports. But I don't want you to think today that I am going to be talking about the Super Bowl, because we are here to minister a word from the Lord. And let me say before I go on, first of all, I give tremendous and great honor to God. I give great honor to the saints of God and to this wonderful group of sisters who have certainly blessed us and encouraged us with anointed praise and worship today, to the music ministry, to the doorkeepers, to all of the saints of God, whoever you are, wherever you are, I praise God for you. Amen. And I pray that God will give you something from this word. Amen. But what I want to share with you today comes from this lesson in 1 Kings, and I want to share it with you and then allow you the opportunity to excuse yourselves and do whatever it is that you're going to be doing today. In this particular passage, we were just there recently and shared some things about Elijah and pray that you remember some of the things that we were able to share with you then. One thing that I want God's people to always be aware of is what God is able to do. despite circumstances. One of the things that I shared with you, for those of you that have taken notes in the past, is that God is able to do the extreme. I have said over and over, He works with and in extreme situations. When we are confronted by and with conflict and with pressure and anxiety, and it seems as though the enemy brings fear and doubt even to the most ardent child of God or saint, what we need during those times are those things that allow us to understand that we have an extreme deliverer. Yes. One who I have said is more than the ordinary. He's extraordinary. He is tremendous in his ability. Some like to think that they are able to do, but I know that God is more than able. And as Paul put it, he even goes beyond our wildest imagination. He is flawless in what he's able to do, flawless in his achievement. Someone has said that I find no fault in him. He is impressive in performance. If you've ever seen him do, if you've ever seen anything that he's done, you know that God is impressive and remarkable in what he does. And certainly he is invaluable as an asset. If you've got God, then you have more than enough. He is infinite in power and wisdom, limitless in his power, and untouchable in his authority. You cannot, regardless of who you are and what you know, where you come from, you cannot undermine the authority of God, because he exceeds all of that. Not only does he exceed that, but he exceeds your hopes and your dreams and your aspirations. He outlasts whatever your expectation is. If you expect for God to take care of you for the time being, God can take care of you not only for now, but for the now and the hereafter. When you come to know him, you understand that he fulfills our joys. There is no greater joy than the God that we serve. And he does all of these things, as I have shared in the past. Well, what does that have to do with the ravens? Let's look at the lesson here and see what God's word is giving us today. In this passage and in the book of Kings, we read about this particular prophet of God, Elijah. Elijah, the Bible calls him the Tishbite, and speaks of where he was from and what he was about. At the time when he comes on the scene, it is not known that he is going to be the awesome prophet that we come to know him to be. But what we see is that he amazingly comes on the scene, and of course, as we get to know him, we discover him to be a miracle-working prophet of an extreme God. I like talking about God as an extreme God, because I want to keep that in your mind. The other character or characters that we have in this book, we have King Ahab. Ahab is known as being a wicked king. The Bible tells us that he was so horrid and did such wicked things that really there was none more wicked than he was. He was selfish and self-absorbed, and I would call him a world pleaser. He just wanted to be like the rest of the world, and he wanted to do what he thought pleased those in the world. And so in turn, he chose for himself, outside of his own people, he chose a woman who had been reared in a kingdom where she believed in idols, false gods, and that kind of worship. This particular woman was named Jezebel. I'm so glad that I really don't come across too many Jezebels by name. For some reason, people don't want to name their daughters Jezebel. If you know about this woman, then I think if you give some credence to wanting to know that you have named your child something that has some value to it, you wouldn't want to name your daughter Jezebel either. But this Jezebel is a one and only. She is a one of a kind. Because of her connection with Ahab, they become husband and wife, he is persuaded by her to do those things that are against his own upbringing and against what he has been taught and what he knows is right. He decides that he wants to, fall in with her and allow the people to follow them in idol worship. And he builds places of worship where they can offer sacrifices to these idols. God, in turn, speaks to Elijah, who is a man of God, and instructs him to tell Ahab that as the Lord God of Israel lives, he says, before whom I stand, that there's going to come a time of famine in this land. There will be no dew, there will be no rain, there will be nothing of moisture falling from the heavens unless you receive a word from me as I have received it from the Lord. And he gives that to Ahab. Now, you've got to know this. Whenever you have an Ahab in existence, it is important to know that for every Ahab, there needs to be an Elijah. For every individual that would strive to draw you away from God, you need somebody who's going to draw you to God. God sends Elijah to Ahab, tells him what he is supposed to tell him, and the word of the Lord then instructs Elijah to run for his life and turn eastward and hide himself by a brook. It is here that the Bible tells us that God does something really, amazing. Because when he goes and hides by the brook Cherith, the Bible says that it was there God told him he could drink from the brook. And this is during a time of famine. But God also says something to him that is amazing, in that God says, I have commanded the ravens to feed you. Now, regardless to what you think about, the ravens, just remember, God has a way of using what God or who God wants to use. In the Bible, the ravens are mentioned more than once. Ravens are the first birds, or a raven is the first bird that we have actually named in the scriptures. For it was in the book of Genesis when God had commanded Noah to build an ark. If you remember correctly, commanded Noah to build this ark. And at the time when God was ready, instructed Noah to go into the ark, to take certain groups of animals into the ark by pairs, and it rained because God said it was going to do so. Noah spent years and years, scores of years, trying to get the people to understand what God had said. Many of them did not believe, neither did they accept what he had to say. But when God got ready, the rain began to fall. The rains fell until the earth was flooded, and when the earth was flooded, there was water everywhere, and the only individuals who were saved on the earth were Noah and his family. They were in the ark. And so after a course of time, the Bible says that Noah, who had been instructed by God how to build the ark, Noah opened the window and sent out the raven. He sent the raven out, no doubt expecting the raven to give him some kind of clue as to whether or not there was some dry land anywhere. But the Bible tells me when Noah sent the raven out, instead of the raven coming back and bringing Noah some sprig of some plant life, that he could tell that somewhere there was some dry land, the Bible says that the raven went out to and fro and just continued to fly around and never did actually come back. It just stayed out there. Eventually, Noah had to send a dove. And so that is the first mention of a raven in the scriptures. Ravens are mentioned elsewhere. We have Moses being instructed by God to let God's children know that ravens were considered in that list of unclean birds or unclean fowls. Isaiah mentions the raven when he talks about the time when God's children, because of judgment, because of their own misdemeanors, would be carried captive. After that time, he said that the land would be so desolate that only the owl and the raven would be able to live there. God has a way of giving us some understanding about the use of this bird if you keep reading the scriptures. But understand, God has a reason for using what God uses. In the Psalms, the Bible tells us that God even feeds the ravens. We learn through the scriptures in the Psalm and in Job what we learn about them, that ravens are the type of birds that don't even take care of their own. They don't even take care of their young. What we learn from science is that these are large black birds. Their bodies are black, their legs are black, their eyes are black, even their beaks are black. They have a very large wingspan. They're able to fly and to soar through the air because their wingspan stretches out at least over 50 inches. And we find that they are not very social creatures. They like to be alone or in pairs, but you don't generally find them in flocks and large groups. One thing that they are known for is that they like to cruise for roadkill. In other words, the ravens like to eat bugs, insects, they eat berries, but they are particularly known for eating dead things. They are unclean birds. They are voracious, they are ravenous, and as I said, according to the scriptures, they don't even provide for their own. The young are left to fend for themselves. Yet we find them to be very smart creatures intelligent creatures, intelligent scavengers who have a certain confidence about them. And so as we look in the passage, the Bible says that God tells the man of God to go hide himself by the brook. The reason he has to hide, again, is because of this wicked king and this wicked individual Jezebel. Because during this time, if you know the scriptures, the God that we serve has allowed someone within the king's own house to help to hide another 100 prophets. They were hidden in caves by groups of 50, and they were fed with bread and water. And so Elijah knows that it's not the most wonderful time to be a prophet in the kingdom. But during this time, he is still a man of God, and God sends him by himself, evidently, by the brook. And it is down there he is able to drink and to satisfy his thirst. While he is satisfying his thirst, God sends the ravens to feed him. And the Bible says he went and did according as God told him to do. Now the question arises, why did God choose the ravens? Why would God choose the ravens? Or perhaps I should say, why shouldn't God choose the ravens? I understand Ahab is wicked, Jezebel is wicked, idolatry is rampant, but God is still at work. Amen. And when you have someone who is evil like Ahab, God chooses Elijah because Elijah is someone who will trust God to the extreme. And so when God tells him to go eastward and to hide by the brook, amen, and we understand that the brook Cherith was a brook that flowed until it emptied into the Jordan. But remember now, there has been no rain, and there will be no rain for a 3-year period. In other words, the land will be in a state of famine. The riverbeds are drying up. Any pool or body of water is drying up. What I'm trying to get you to understand, people of God, there will come times in our lives when it seems as though everything that is valuable has been taken from us. It will be a time when we will be faced with devastation and famine, and that which we just know that we need seems to be getting away from us and out of our reach. But God, remember, as I have said, is an extreme God who works in extreme situations. There are many of us who have dealt with some serious blows from the enemy. He has struck at us and caused us to think and to feel that we are losing our grip on what we have. But remember, we sang the song this morning, amen, my anchor holds and grips the solid rock. You've got to get a hold of God if you want to be able to make it. This bird that was mentioned in the scripture, this bird was just flying around, going to and fro, minding its own business, these ravens. But God commanded them, the Bible said, to feed the prophet of God. There are just a few points, and I'm almost done, that I want you to get from this lesson. The first thing I want you to know, and trying to notice is that it was not Elijah's choice, neither was it Elijah's decision to be fed by ravens. If he had had his choice, he would have preferred, as you and I probably would, with my imagination, I would think that he would want God to send him an angel. Yes, send me an angel. Well, later on, God did send him an angel. If you go over a couple of chapters more, amen, to feed him. But understand, this was not Elijah's choice, and it was not his decision, and it could not be his choice, neither could it be his decision, because as God has spoken, amen, through other prophets, God gives us the understanding that his thoughts are not our thoughts, and his ways are not our ways. Not only that, but even as far as the earth and the heavens are apart, we've got to understand that sometimes there is a great chasm between our thoughts and God's thoughts. We would like to think sometime that we've got it all in proper perspective and that we've got it in the right place at the right time in the right way. But let me tell you something, until you get to understand that you don't know what you think you know, then you don't have the place in God that you think you have. Elijah, amen, it was not his choice. If he could have chosen, I don't believe that he would have chosen for God to send a dirty bird, amen, to feed him. But look how God works. The Bible gives us this explanation. This was God's command, because the Bible says God told him that he had commanded the raven to feed him. Not only was it not Elijah's choice, but understand, it probably was not the raven's choice either. Because if the raven had done and continued to do what the ravens had been doing, no doubt all the ravens would have done would have been to go to and fro. Where do we see that phrase again in the scriptures? Do we not see that phrase when it comes, amen, to us talking about Satan? Remember, the Bible says in the book of Job, when the sons of God were come together, when God, no doubt, had called a board meeting, when God had a meeting, and the sons of God came and presented themselves and let God know that they were present, along with them came Satan. He, no doubt, had not received the same kind of invitation, but he felt that he could come because he had heard there was a meeting. And when he got to the meeting, God asked him where he'd been, and he told God that he was going to and fro. Amen. The ravens were going to and fro, but God has a way of letting everything and everybody know that he's in control. That's what the devil is about. But when God commands something, respond and look at what they do. God tells them, I want you to go in the morning and I want you to go in the evening. Twice a day, I want you to go before the dawn of a new day and I want you to go at dusk. I want you to feed my servant. Isn't it wonderful just to think that God would use even your enemy? Is this not what the Bible teaches us? That he will make your enemy your footstool. I'm almost done. Hallelujah. Oh yes, the ravens came and they fed God's servant.
Amen.
somebody. They only hang out maybe in pairs, or you might find three of them together, but that's about it. They don't like to hang out in large groups. They don't like to hang out in big flocks because they have minds of their own. They are very self-confident. They like to do their own thing. They don't want to hear from nobody else because they think they're their own boss. And those black birds with those black beaks and those black legs and those black bodies and those black eyes, those birds have a mind of their own. But when God speaks, I don't care how impressive you may think you are. When God speaks, you've got to move. So God commands the bird. This is what I want you to do. I've got a man of mine sitting down by the brook, and I have commanded him to be there. And when you go and you find bread and you find meat, I want you to bring that meat and I want you to feed my man. Hallelujah. And so the birds came when God told them to come. Look at this sovereign God. God told them what to do. God told them when to do it. God told them what to bring. They had nothing to do but to obey the voice of God. Hallelujah. Amen. And then thirdly, if God has to dry up a brook or cut off your provision, God will tell you when to move again. Because after Elijah had been there over a while, amen, then God let the brook dry up. And when the brook dried up, Elijah had to move. God will tell you when it's time to go. He'll tell you where to go. He'll tell you what to do. And he'll tell you when to move. Presents to us as a people of God. Amen. And you've got to understand that this is what it's about. It's not just about dirty birds. It's not just about drying up brooks. It's not just about the when, the what, and the where. But the main thing that you learn from this lesson is that regardless of your circumstance, regardless of what's going on, and regardless of what's not going on, this is one thing I want you to remember, and I don't want you to forget it. Have you got your ears open? Amen. Are you in tune? Do you know what it's about? When you look at this story, there's one thing that you learn without a shadow of a doubt. There's one thing that I'm convinced of in my spirit. There's one thing that I take from this passage, that the devil